Okay, today we're going to be doing chapter 9. Chapter 9 gets into the nozzles themselves, hydraulic nozzles, which we commonly refer to as injector nozzles or fuel injectors, but they're hydraulic because it's fluid pressurizing something. So fluid nozzle, hydraulic fluid nozzles, their primary purpose is to atomize and distribute pressurized fuel to the combustion chamber. So it's a pretty simple task. Pretty elaborate tasks. So that's their primary job. So basic construction, the most common type of nozzle used today consists of two pieces, the nozzle valve and the nozzle or the needle valve and the nozzle body itself. So most of what we have are unitized or pieces. We can remove them, put them back in. The nozzle holder encloses the nozzle valve, spring assembly providing a compact component. And so that compact component, it'll look like one of these. So just a small little piece is all, this is my injector. So just because you're gonna see these initials, as I was reading through, these initials that you see, they throw them around in your book. This ACR, they throw it in your first chapter, the first page of this chapter. And I thought, what is an ACR? So I had to go to the back of the book, look it up in the back of the book. And then, what page is it on? Well, it's on a page clear up here in chapter 11. Something, you use an acronym of something that we haven't even got to yet. So, and they didn't even mention the page that we were on, and it had that initials on that page. So, you're gonna see them. I seen this one earlier, and I thought, I don't remember reading that. What is an HEUI? So I kind of can figure out somewhat what it was, but so you will know. They use the H, the E, the U and the I, hydraulically actuated, electronically controlled, unit, so it's an item that can be removed, unit, injector. This is a very common, today you're gonna see that acronym all over the place. Common rail, start referring to it as CR, so they're using, writing out common rail. ACR is amplified common rail. And that's using an injector that is got a piece inside that they take the already high pressure of a common rail and they actually make it even higher. So it's amplified, it means 2 to 1, they make it twice as much pressure than what the common rail is. And we're going to be seeing that in chapter 11, so I'm going to leave it until then. And then unit injectors, which is kind of what we're going to be looking more at today. So smoke from worn nozzles is one of the major causes of emissions. It is one of the major problems that we deal with and why we take injectors out and have to repair them is because they're worn. So common problem. Here's our nozzle shooting on top of a direct injection engine. It's got to do a lot of things. It's got to be atomized. It's got to have a pattern that sprays correctly in this cavity that's provided for you in the piston. Then it has to do it at the right time. So it's got to be able to do a lot of stuff in a short period of time. So it's got to create a lot of turbulence to be able to swirl and break that fuel apart. What makes an injector work? So the injector itself, the tip of the injector, this is my needle, this is the tip. The tip of it itself actually seats down in the bottom of the injector, and that's what seals the bottom of the injector. This injector is actually sealed, so combustion gases cannot come back up. When we put pressure to it, the yellow represents fuel. Fuel is pressurizing it. It pushes on the outside body here. Just like a hydraulic cylinder and hydraulics, it can't push out the cylinder, can't push the end of the cylinder, starts pushing against the piston itself. Our piston here happens to have tapers on it, but it's still pushing pressure equally on both sides, but also pushing up. So that hydraulically, I'm pressurizing and pushing the needle up against the spring. The needle's gonna go up. When it comes up, it exposes this hole, and the fuel is gonna be shot out. So that's basically how it's going to work. And then we're going to alter a whole bunch of stuff on the top to make it do that similar thing. So referred to as a needle valve, so the piece that goes in the middle is our needle valve. And then the nozzle body is the piece that actually has the holes in it. If you look really close in the picture, you can see there's a little dot right here. The hole that's in one of these injectors is really small. And it can have anywhere from 4 to 13 holes. On top of that nozzle body are going to be some other holes. One of the holes is where fuel is kind of traveling down, and other holes are where it bleeds back. So it's going to bleed past the injector, and that's what lubricates and cools the injector. That stuff goes back to the fuel tank, and it takes some of the air that might get trapped in there, allows that to go away. So there's going to be some extra holes in there to help move that stuff away. Here is an injector kind of taken apart, two different kinds of injectors. This is the body up here. You'll see that there's a little pipe coming out the side. The actual high pressure line is attached to the very end, and then this is the bleed off that leaks back and is going to go back to the tank. So here's those holes that we just looked at. We have a spring. We have a pressure pin that's pushing against the spring, and then there's some kind of a shim. The pressure that the injector actually opens is controlled by the adjusting shim. So the adjusting shim, you change that shim, put more shims or less shims, and that changes my opening pressure. Over here is a similar one. Instead of having this little metal pipe coming out the side, this one actually has two O-rings, and there's like a round big washer looking piece that slips on there, and that actually is sealed by the O-rings. Still got the same kind of nozzle body, something to hold it. We have our spring. We have our pressure pin, which looks a little different, does the same job. Intermediate disc is what's going to be shutting it off. And then we got our nozzle body here. I'm going to pass around two different nozzle bodies. Not nozzle bodies, but actually the nozzle body. So this one here is going to be a direct injection, and this one here is going to be indirect injection. And the indirect, you'll notice, is very flat. So the surface is flat. There's a little pintle piece sticking out. If I were to pull the nozzle, the needle out of the middle, then that little piece is missing. So that tip of this needle actually comes out the end. If you were to hold that needle in your hand and leave the rest of it on the table, your hand, the warmth of your hand, would make it to where you can't put that back in. That's how finite it is. Direct injection has a little tip that sticks up there on the end. If you look at it really, really close, you'll see little teeny pinholes in there. This one, their holes are big enough that you can actually see them with your naked eye. When you get up into the modern super high pressure ones, those are so finite that you can't see them. So this one again has a needle, goes down the middle, and it's metal to metal precision. So I'll give this to you and you can focus on it with him. So that way it'll be easier if you're closer. So even though there are different kinds, they're still similar philosophy, other than one has multiple holes, one has a single hole. Basic operation and test. If you're working on the older system, mechanical ones, we're going to use a nozzle tester, fuel injector tester, and we're going to be looking for four different things. That's all we're really looking for. The first one's going to be opening pressure. When we put it on the tester, we crank the handle down. We're looking for what pressure does it actually spray fuel out. And you should be able to come right up to that pressure, and then boom, it'll actually open that. So it's very, very precise. Second thing that I'm looking for is the pattern. What pattern does the fuel actually come out of that nozzle? If it is an indirect injection, then it should be a very thin, long, conical shape. If it is a multi-orifice direct injection, it should be coming either straight out the side or slightly in a down position. And I'm looking for how many holes do I have? Are the patterns similar in shape, what do they look like? So I'm looking at what that pattern is that's being provided. The third thing I'm looking for is leakage. So you bring the pressure up, let's say the pressure is supposed to be 1900, you'll bring it up to 1700, 1750, you hold it for 10 seconds, and it should not drip off the end of the injector. So it's a simple quick drip test. And the fourth one I'm looking for is a chatter. So I'm looking for the sound that it makes. And a good injector is gonna have a squeak or a kind of a screech sound to it. If I go down real slow, it should go pop, 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 and should have a nice crisp puffing of fuel. Fuel should shoot, 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 shoot. And you just get individual shots. And so it should be nice and steady. If it's not, it'll just kind of like stream out. You'll see a stream. You see a stream, that's bad. I want atomized fuel coming out of there. We're gonna do a short video later, hopefully tomorrow, where we'll actually demonstrate the nozzle rater tester, and you'll actually get to see these four tests in action. So I don't wanna do it in here, because when we do that, it's atomized and the fuel's gonna fill the classroom full of fuel vapor, and I don't wanna try to talk to you with fuel vapor floating around. So we want to do it somewhere where there's a vent that can suck it away, and we don't want it to get all over the place. So that's why we're not going to demonstrate it in class. But we're going to be doing these four tests. So it's going to go pretty quick. So air damage, if you are getting air in it, it could be that you or your filter is loose. You could have a fuel line that's loose. You have a holes in the fuel line. Their fuel line starts to get cracked. There's a lot of things that can get air into a diesel fuel system. We already talked about it, but air in a diesel fuel system is bad. And you don't want that in there. It's going to cause damage to your nozzle and to other pieces. So the size of the annular, which is the angle. So when you look at your nozzles, there's an angle right here. The size and the shape of that annular, along with the spring, is what's going to determine what pressure and what shape things are going to look at. So that's what fuel's pushing against and will determine the pressure that it pops off on. And it's going to determine lift. So here's my needle coming down the middle, seals down here all the way at the very bottom. It comes up. My fuel high pressure system's coming in here. It's pushing up on the needle. The needle's pushing against the spring, and the spring is going to open up and let fuel come out. Nozzle differential ratio. Diesel engine fuel systems require an abrupt beginning and end of injection. We do not want it to be a delayed. We don't want it to slow out or kind of peter out. We want crisp, quick, boom. So it's got to start and stop very crisp. And so the way they're designed with the angles and the springs, that's what they do. They're going to open up, and as soon as that pressure drops, they bam, they close instantly. So they're very quick. The sudden drop in fuel pressure when that opens up and that fuel goes away, since there's no more fuel coming behind it to help keep pushing it, as soon as the pressure drops, it instantly shuts off. So they're able to actually, you know, adjust and set and control very well with the design of the injector. Pentel nozzles is what we're going to be using for the indirect injection. So that's going to be this one that had the piece sticking out the end. Pentel injectors have a single hole. They're used only in direct supposed to be indirect injection. Missed an eye there. Rate shaped Pentel nozzles are a newer style. They actually have a different design with the spring in there, and it actually has a way of controlling the volume and the spray pattern. So the way the tip itself is designed, as it opens up, it actually slows down and it lets some fuel go through, but not the main body of the fuel. And by putting a little bit of fuel, it's like doing the pilot injection with the electronic styles. And so it lets a little bit of fuel, gets that fire burning, and then the main injection, the main piece comes in. And we'll see that a little bit more with some stuff further in this presentation, like the double spring and stuff like that. Air cushions, they're talking about air leaks. We already looked at that yesterday, the day before. Get air in there. When this thing slams up, air doesn't cushion, air doesn't lubricate, and when it hits there, it's going to damage that tip. So here they're talking about the back leakage. Back leakage is the fuel that's traveling past the tip, going back up and going back to the fuel tank, cooling and lubrication purposes. And in between the two is going to be a disc. They have a little pin that kind of keeps them from rotating. If it were to rotate, the holes would plug, get covered up. They'd be plugged. If we don't let that leak back to the tank, then the pressure builds up in there, and then the spring can't go because it's like liquid iron, and the nozzle will quit working. So it has to have a pin, a locating pin, to keep it in line. These pieces here are all lapped, and they're mated perfectly. And so the way the spring attaches or pushes on them, sometimes it'll wear a groove, and you'll start getting leakage from the high pressure piece into the holes. So when I went to college, and I've done it sometime since then, we had a little super vine lapping pad with jeweler's ruse, and we would do the little figure eight that we talked about, some other things that we were doing. And so you do a figure eight, and I've actually polished these up and cleaned them super well because you got a lapping compound in there. Lapped them up and put new needle in there and a new tip, and they were perfectly fine. So you can actually save them. They're just time consuming. So these surfaces have to be polished, matched, perfect. If they have any kind of groove or wear in them, they're not going to work. So you either buy all new stuff or you can fix some of it. So here's my injector needle that's actually moving up. So they talk about rate shaping a lot. And these newer injectors do a lot of rate shaping. And that's just, instead of getting a single square shot of fuel, we're able to modify the fuel rate and try to get something that's a little more useful. So the needle, the tip of the needle as it opens up, the fuel volume is reduced, kind of like that pilot injection, and then as it goes up further, you get a larger hole, larger volume, and that's more of the main injection. So it's a modified system where in mechanical system, you can't open it multiple times like the electronic, but there is ways to kind of getting it to be a reduced opening and then a maximum opening. So they keep talking about this rate shaping. So direct injection, we're going to be using multi-orifices. It can have anywhere from 4 to 13. The old style low pressure ones were 4 or 5 usually. The newest direct injection ones may have as many as 13 holes. You put 13 holes and you start putting 20,000 PSI, those holes are going to be so small that you probably can't see them with your naked eye. So they're very small. With direct injection, there's a greater need for atomization and ability to distribute the fuel within the cylinder itself. And so that's why they have more than one hole, and that's why they have more pressure. Indirect injection, we're going to be somewhere between 1500, probably at the lowest, we're at 1500, and 2800 is the highest pressure we used that I've seen really under indirect injection. In direct injection, we were somewhere between 3 and 5500. So same vintage of machines. You can see with direct injection, we have more holes and we have higher pressure trying to atomize more because it's all done right there in the cylinder. New stuff, the electronic stuff that's out there today, we can be over, all of them are virtually over 20,000 PSI. And I've seen numbers go up somewhere around, I think 45,000 is the highest I've seen. So there's some really high atomization pressures now. So you think about it, even 20,000 compared to the old 5,500, you're gonna get a lot better atomization today, even at the lowest end, than as you did in the old machines at the highest end. So hydraulically balanced nozzle valves. So the first ones we looked at, you had a nozzle and the nozzle has a spring on it. You basically have fuel pressure pushing the spring up, and that's what actually balanced the two. So then they started using technology and then they went to hydraulic. And so that's where we use hydraulic pressure, not a spring pressure, to hold the nozzle against the seat. So we're actually either using high pressure above it, which is hydraulically pushing it down. We may use engine oil. So they may actually take the engine oil, jack the pressure of the engine oil up, and use that to hold it down, and use that to control it. And, or we may actually use diesel fuel, pressurize it and hold it down. So either diesel fuel or engine oil. All common rail, some of these hydraulic, electronic, unitized injectors, and other unit injectors use high pressure oil or fuel. So if I'm going to replace the nozzle, it's not an uncommon thing to actually take the tip off and actually replace it as a maintenance item. They wear, it's like your glow or your spark plugs wear out on a car. Well, the tips on these, after a while, they just wear out. And so you start seeing excess smoke or issues with your engine, take it out, you do a test on them, and the spray pattern is hosing off to one side. And so you can clean it up or you just replace them. So when I buy nozzles, they come in a little container like this. So this container has the new nozzle in it, and it comes with diesel fuel in it. So it comes bathed in diesel fuel, so you don't take it out until you're ready to do something with it. But when I buy a new tip, that's what I get, is the little piece in the middle, the needle in the middle, and the nozzle on the outside. Those two are the two pieces that wear, and that's what you replace.
So is the needle the same kind of needle? Obviously not the same kind of needle, but similar to the one you use in covered?
No, not even remotely close. Way harder. Deals with a lot more higher temperatures. The needle is way different than you would find in a carburetor. Carburetors are real soft. They're not that big a deal. These are super hard. They got to deal with a lot of pressure, a lot of temperature, and a lot of other things. So injector tip of a 2006 common rail has 7. So this particular one has 7. And the holes, right there's the hole in this picture, but they're like, if you took a little stick pin needle and that's what it would be. You would not want to like see if the hole is clean with one of those. We'll talk about that, but that's what it is. This particular injector here, we have fuel coming in. So whatever the fuel pressure is comes down here, it's pushing against my needle. My needle is seated here so I can't inject anything. It's sealed here simply because it's machined that way. And the fuel itself will seal it up so no fuel comes up here. We have that same fuel pressure on the top. So just like in our hydraulics class, you have same pressure top and bottom. It's going to be balanced. It's even. We have a electric solenoid on the top. We have a restricted orifice right here. When we want to inject the fuel, the electronic solenoid is going to activate. The plunger is going to come up. When the plunger comes up, this orifice is back to the tank. So I lose the hydraulic pressure on the top. I still have hydraulic pressure on the bottom. The needle is going to go up. All we need is a real light spring in here to kind of help push it back down. And so I have balanced pressure plus a light spring, and I'm holding it against the seat. And this pressure, when it's pressurized, it's got a lot of pressure holding it down against the seat. This is an example of, you know, instead of using a spring to do all the work, we're going to use high pressure, either oil or diesel fuel. In this case, it would be the fuel. And so the fuel is pushing on it, and we're controlling it by either relieving it or not relieving it. And we, in the hydraulics class, seen that over and over where they use relief valves, and this is a pilot-operated relief valve. So they took that concept, put it into a fuel injector. So we're just going to relieve the pressure on the top. We have a restricted orifice right here. Boom, it's going to go up. As soon as I plug that hole up, this pressure is going to build. Boom, slams back down and shuts the injector off. And I can pull that off a couple of times and get that pilot, main, post, pre, all those different pieces we want. Here's a cutaway kind of showing that same thing. High pressure fuel is coming in, it's coming down, it's pushing on both sides. Got my needle valve spring coming up, and then the solenoid's actually at the top. Construction, matching nozzles. So precise matching of the injector to the shape of the piston bowl and turbulence of direct injection chambers is critical. So if I have my direct injection nozzle, because it has, let's say, five holes, because this is an old style, because it has five holes, if I stick this in there and then I rotate it and tighten it down, now instead of all five holes shooting up into the cylinder, now they're going to shoot down, because they're not going to go in there straight. Usually these older ones are going at an angle. So you have a piston that's this direction, this nozzle's here. So it's going to be designed to shoot horizontal and kind of shoot back. So less coming back, more coming forward, and the angle's got to match the shape of the piston. If you were to rotate it, now it's going to shoot down and shoot up. It's just going to hit the cylinder wall and top the piston. That would be bad. So all of them will have something, some form, to make sure you can't rotate it wrong. So they say don't do that, but the engineer said, we don't trust you. And they're going to make it to where when I stick this in, this hose pipe right here is going to fit down into a groove and it won't allow me. I couldn't bolt this down if I had it in wrong. So luckily, that's what they do. Same as this one. This is called a pencil injector. I don't know where you guys know why I got the name.
It looks like a pencil.
And so this is John Deere pencil injector, real thin, and it also only goes in one way. So it's the same style. It's going to go in at an angle, but you can't put it in wrong. So it's critical for turbulence and everything that goes in right. You'd want to make sure you put it in right. So low power, let's say I went ahead and I pulled it out, I put it back in. Now I feel like, hey, I just don't have the same power anymore. One of the reasons may be if you replace the tip and the tip now is not wore, it's actually back to the right shape. If it was overfueling because the tip was wore, more fuel translates into more power. So what controls the amount of horsepower and torque out of a diesel engine? The fuel. So you got to have fuel, you got to have air. And as long as I have excess amount of air, if I put more fuel in, I'm going to have more horsepower. So if I replace a worn tip and my horsepower goes down, it may be because the old ones were wore and they were injecting more. Usually when they're wore and they're injecting more, you don't really get a big increase in horsepower, because when they're wore and inject more, they usually do it in a poor form. So instead of being atomized, they'll be more of a stream. And so with that stream, you start losing quality of combustion, so you don't get the usable horsepower. So in there they talk about, you know, maybe because worn, the second one may be that nozzle needs to get wore in. So it may need to actually break in and actually seat itself better, and then it might work. So after a couple hundred poundings in there, a couple of hours, it'll actually seat itself better and actually perform better. So here's a multi-tip, a multi-orifice nozzle tip. So the spray angles, the hole diameters, the hole lengths, and other features are not usually visible. They're not all the same. It may be the injector comes in at an angle like this, your piston is traveling across, this is coming in between two valves, could be coming between four valves. Usually if there's four valves, they put it in the middle. If there's two valves, it's going to be off to the side, kind of shooting down. If it is, there'll be small holes with very small shallow angle, and then larger holes on the upper side that are shooting out across the piston. And so there is differences. You may see one or two holes and not see the other ones. They may be so small you can't see them. So get a magnifying glass and, oh, there it is. This particular one has a locating ball that prevents it, has a slot, slides down the slot. So each one has something that's going to keep you from putting it in wrong. Nozzle manufacturers, there's an enormous degree of expertise in special materials and design work in a nozzle. They're extremely high temperatures, extreme high pressures. The metal has to hold up under a lot of nasty environmental issues that go on. When you think about it, a needle opens and closes over a billion times in its life. So between the time it's new and when you decide I need to replace it, it could easily open and close a billion times. And it has to hold up and stay consistent in that lifespan. And we start looking at how small those holes are and how precise that needle is, that's a pretty incredible piece of tooling. So variable geometry injectors currently under development use two or more rows of orifices. All the injectors that I've seen, all the ones that we deal with, have a row of injector tips or holes that's actually shooting out. They have stuff that's under development where they'll have two rows. And as the nozzle needle itself starts to come up, it's going to expose one row of nozzles, and that's going to spray out. If I want more fuel, it keeps moving up, exposes more holes and more volume. So that pilot injection or variable, I want more horsepower, instead of just opening up and all the holes are exposed, they're actually opening and actually exposing more holes. So that's currently in development, and you'll probably see those in the future. So there's a lot of changes there. The nozzles themselves, these are very highly blown up pictures of orifices. So when they machine them or build them, they take a drill bit and they drill a hole. And you think, hey, that looks like a nice polished surface. And then you blow it up and you're like, whoa, not so polished. So it starts out looking really rough like this. This looks really rough. And then they have a process where they actually shoot an abrasive material through it and actually polish it more. So after they've ran the polishing machine material through it, now it looks more like this. You'll notice it's still not smooth. But this looks smoother than that one. This one you see here has some ragged edges on it, and here the edges are kind of smoothed out. So they're actually rounding the edges off a little bit, giving it a little bit of radius for the fuel to travel over, and getting rid of some of these jagged edges. So this little double line is this picture right here. So they zeroed in on it. So, and you can see here it's pretty ragged, and here it's starting to get smoother. So after they drill it, sometimes they use kind of a laser. There's various things that they use to make these holes. And then they run something through it to actually smooth them up. Because rough material causes turbulence and will affect fuel flow. So I just find this amazing what they do, and how do you drill such a precise hole that small? That's some incredible tooling. Even back here, they're talking about these areas, they're going to drill them, they start out square, and then they use some kind of abrasive material that they travel through it, spray through it, and it rounds out the edges and makes it smooth. Rate shaping with double springs, so we talked about how we're going to do that. Here we got two springs. Controlling of the rate of fuel discharge from the nozzle is an important element. By adding more than one or changes in fuel volume by doing the pilot and the post, or trying to change the volume over time, so putting a little bit in and then increasing the rate, we're going to minimize noise, we're going to reduce emissions and increase fuel economy. So that noise, that NOx, NOx that we have that we're trying to get rid of, we can start to control that by doing multiple shots, a rate change. So the operation of two springs, there's a light spring and a heavy spring, and the light spring moves, and the heavy spring, it hits the heavy spring, it slows it down. So the nozzle starts to come up, hits the heavy spring, it stops or slows down. Pressure has to increase before it can move the heavy spring. And by doing that, I'm going to get a almost like a pilot injection and then a post injection. So that's kind of how they do it in a more crude fashion. So needle lift sensors, they also put on the top of the injector some kind of sensor. That sensor can actually meter or measure that variation, that vibration that takes place, sends a signal to my car, to my computer, my ECU, and we can actually change the rate and make it to where it smooths it out. And we've already seen that once, you'll see it again. So here's a picture of it. It actually has a spring here and there's a spring here. So a light spring pops up and then hits the heavy spring, and that's going to slow it down. So we'll get a small amount of fuel and then a heavy amount of fuel. And then this is that electronic piece that just adds a big price tag to the injector. But this sensor that's bolted on or attached to the injector, and this is monitoring that injector output. And here's what it looks like in real life on the outside. So there's two kinds of leakages that are coming from an injector. One of them, they call it forward leakage and backwards leakage. Forward would be stuff that's coming out the nozzle tip, the end of the injector itself here. And that would be in the cylinder. So if the tip of this leaks like it's not supposed to, it's going to leak into the cylinder. It's going to actually create a puddle. So if this thing starts to leak and drip, builds up on the puddle on the cylinder, and then that cylinder, when it starts to burn, that fuel burns away and actually can melt a hole into the piston. So that would be a bad thing. It also creates air in the nozzle. So if this tip is leaking, that means that air can actually pull up in it, because liquid's going out, air's going to go in, we'll get air in here, and we'll actually have spongy operation of the nozzle. So that would be bad. Carbon is pushed up. If fuel can leak out, combustion gases can push in, so that combustion pressure pushing in is going to go inside, and with it's going to carry carbon particles, and the carbon particles are going to start plugging it up. So you have trash in there. That seat that the needle sits against is going to be dirty, and it'll create further leakage and deterioration of the nozzle. It also will overheat, because if it can, when the seat sits there, it actually dissipates heat through the needle. If the needle is not seated, it's going to overheat. And when the combustion gases start traveling up inside of there, it moves that heat up inside the nozzle. So it causes a lot of problems if you have leakage at the tip. The second one is back leakage. The back leakage is stuff that's going back to the fuel tank. That leakage is kind of built in, and it is built in, and it's used for cooling and lubrication. So you need to have some kind of leakage past the injector going back to the tank. Has to be some. If it's more than a few drops per minute, the injector may be bad. So if you take the hose off and you see a lot of fuel coming out of there, it's because that internal parts are wore, and when they get wore, then the nozzle stops working. So that's kind of a troubleshooting thing that tells you I have an injector problem. Nozzle tester. So we'll zero in on this tester. We're not going to actually use the tester today, but this is a nozzle tester that you will thread your nozzle on there. We pump the handle, it builds the pressure up. We watch our gauge. This part down here is just a reservoir holding fuel. So this becomes my nozzle test. So I'm going to pump this thing, bring the pressure up, and then watch the fuel come pouring out. So this small little pretty box here, because it's the color blue, the price is $510. So it's not something that you're going to just throw pocket change around and have around. On top of having the nozzle tester, I also have to have fittings. And since there's a lot of differences in fittings and how they're attached, you have to have a bunch of fittings to try to get whatever it takes to seal this up to be able to do the test. So that's probably our biggest challenge, is trying to find the fitting. And I've had situations where I'll have, you know, five or six different fittings before I can finally get back to a fitting that actually holds my nozzle and tightens it up. So when we bought this one, it came with this particular pipe on it, and this pipe didn't work for anything that we had. So we had to go buy a special pipe and get a different set of fittings, and then it fits some of what we have. We still don't have all of them. So in the future here, we'll be watching this in action. So that tester is what we're going to be using. there's going to be a picture of another tester that's really fancy, and I don't even know what that, I mean, if that one's $500, the one that we'll see is electronic, controls the electronic ones, it's going to be thousands of dollars. But so that's what we check. Factors that reduce the life of this injector: fuel quality. So buying cheap fuel that's stale, doesn't have good lubricity in it, or all the other bad things that come with bad fuel. Dirt, it's not clean fuel, you're using dirty containers, you leave your gas cap off and you just put a rag in there because, you know, it costs too much money to buy a cap, so I'm going to go buy an injection system because the cap's too expensive. Lubricity, stale fuel, bad quality fuel, excessive heat, my cooling system's plugged up, I got a scale line buildup in my cooling system, my radiator's plugged up, all the different things that could create heat, running the wrong, don't need a return line, that's going to cause some issues. If I run the wrong fuel, I'm running number one fuel because, hey, I got 500 gallons sitting there, I don't want to just leave it there, so let's just burn it. And it's July, we got this heat wave, and we're out there burning number one fuel in July. Bad idea. And so that's going to create excessive heat. So there's a lot of things you can do that would cause those problems. Water, so we've talked about water a lot. You put the wrong filter, it doesn't wick the water away, it starts running through. And then improper service, I'm actually just not clean. When you guys take your engines apart, how many of you guys took the lines off and then capped off all those pieces so neuro dirt got down inside of this hole? I had some of you that capped half of them but not the other half, and so you always want to open them up and you want to cap them. So luckily we're, you know, pretty enclosed shop, we don't have a lot of air traveling through because we got air conditioning, and so we don't have a lot of dirt. But if you're a normal shop, you know, they open the bay doors up in the morning and at night they shut them down for theft protection, and that's about it. So all day long there's dust blown in and out, and if you leave that open for 15 minutes you got dirt in there. So you want to make sure you have a good box of caps and you cap off everything. Open it up, cap, open it up, cap. Everything should be capped off. This is the drip test. So 10 seconds hold pressure, and you want to come right up to that opening pressure, drop it down just 500 psi, hold it, and it should not physically drip. Might get a little bit wet here, but it should not physically drip off in those 10 seconds. This is the leak off lines. So this particular one has one of these, I don't know what we call that, it's a name for it, like a banjo fitting, I think is what we call it. Banjo fitting is like a pipe that has a pipe coming out the side. So it goes over, there's an O-ring here, there's an O-ring here, here's the hole. So the fuel comes out the hole, goes on the inside of the banjo, goes on down the system. If it's leaking, you need to replace the O-rings. If you take it apart, you replace the O-rings. Always replace the sealing surface. Some of these with banjos will have brass washers on them, some of them have aluminum washers. They're designed to be used once. You put them in there, you torque them down, it squishes, they don't unsquish once you take them apart. So you put it all together and you're like, oh, I forgot to do something else. And you take it back apart, really you should be putting new fitting. It's a brand new washer, but you need to put a washer in there. So that'll cause you to have leaks. So don't let that happen. Spray patterns, so you're doing your little pattern test. So one of those four tests, cranking it down, is it a nice cone shape, is it a multi-injector, a multi-hole one, and it shoots out, is it nice and even, or is it missing? So I'm supposed to have five holes and I only have four things shooting out, one of them is completely plugged, happens. So I'm looking for my pattern, what does it look like? Here's that cheap one that Kendall's going to buy, donate it to us, because he's rich. So this thing here is electronic. So they're up here and they're typing in and saying, here's what we got, go. And it's electronically controlling it and actually shooting it out, checking everything out. But you're looking at thousands of dollars for this tool. So not something that any shop's gonna have. It's gonna be a diesel fuel shop. who would have something like this? A $500 one, you know, there are a lot of shops out there that have a simple fuel injector tester. If they're doing a lot of engine work, you know, $500 is nothing. It's going to cost them $500 and a couple of trips to the local fuel shop to get their nozzles tested. So, and if you have it, you'll test all of your injectors. And if they're good, you put them right back in. It's not a big deal. You don't have time wasted. So having one of those makes sense if you're dealing with a lot of diesel engines that are old technology. So it pays. These two injectors are the same thing. And so this piece right here, this is where the nozzle little hole should be. This one, that piece is missing. One reason, so this is like where the little holes are, these little notches here, that could have happened because of water. If you have water and that tip is hot, when the water hits it, first of all, water molecules are larger than fuel molecules, so the physical size, it just physically tears its way out. Second thing is, when it gets hot, it turns to steam. The pressure of steam, when it expands, blows the tip right off. The other thing that can bend or break these tips, especially the direct injection ones, you got that little tip and it goes into your head, and so you pull your head off, what do you do with it? Set it on the table. So when you set it on the table, that tip is sticking out the end and it smashes that tip. So you want to be careful when you pull any kind of head off, don't flip the head over to take the valves out or to clean a gasket. You always want to make sure you get your injectors out beforehand, because that's an expensive. So you're out there on that big heavy metal table and you kind of drop it and you took the tip off. These are all unit injectors, and you just see different kinds of generations. This one here is mechanical, this one's electronic, that one's electronic, and this one is controlled electronically here. So I haven't seen any of these in our industry. I don't know what we have now with the new common rail. So it's just stuff that's going to be out there. Unit pumps. Unit pumps is going to be something that has one pumping element controlling one cylinder. So on the table here is a green engine. This is an Onan engine. It has unit pumps. This is the pumping element. This is the injector. So the pumping element goes in over here on the side of the engine. There's a fuel cam, actually just the camshaft that runs the valves, goes through right underneath there. This is going to be running on the camshaft. And this injector is going to be up here in the head, and there's actually a pipe that connects the two. So this injector thing is connected with a pipe. But each injector pump is individual. On the side over here is a little pin that sticks out that moves. Somebody got this one wet, so it's kind of rusting. But anyway, this piece that moves is going to be what controls fuel volume. There's a rod that goes all the way through. It's connected to my governor, and the governor is going to be moving this, and it controls fuel volume. And we'll be looking at this a little bit more later on. So metering, timing, pressurization is all done by a single pump. Each pump is individual. There's a mechanism that you would put the injector in and or pump in, and then you would time all the pumps together. So John Deere has a 60, 50 to 70 horse tractor. And I forgot what the model of the engine is, but it has all individual pumps. There's a plate that you take off the side, and you have to actually go in and adjust each one of those so that all of the cylinders fire the same way. So there's a whole mechanism in the book, tells you how to do it, go through, and you time all the pumps together. So it would be a pump setup like that one. And it's inside the block, so you gotta take a cover and reach inside the block and do it. Advantages before common rail, that style of individual pumps had the highest injection pressure, so they were really good for that. And you notice that goes with a direct injection nozzle, so it kind of makes sense. And the problem with them is the pressure is related to cam speed. Slower the engine, the slower that's going to build pressure, the lower the pressure is going to be. Engine cranks up, it's running at high RPM, and that's going to be traveling faster, and we're going to build more pressure. So there's a direct relation between speed and pressure available to the injector. We have a lot more problems at an idle trying to get stuff to atomize really well, and then it's accentuated by the fact that it's running off the cam. So it's not good. Construction of this individual system is, it's mechanically pressurized. There's a lot of times there'll be the newer styles have electronically controlled for governing, timing, and metering functions. So we've seen in a couple of slides back the four injectors, those were all unitized, but they had electronics controlling the actual metering, governing, and timing of them. Injection metering and timing is done with an electronic signal sent to the unit injector solenoid, actuated spill or poppet valve. So we've seen that multiple slides back where that poppet valve opens up and relieves it. So that's how it's actually controlling it. So the solenoid is going to open, dumps the pressure, injector is going to shut off. Pressure builds up, injector is going to actually open, and the solenoid is actually relieving the pressure and stopping the injection. Correct quantity of fuel at the precise time commanded by the ECU or ECM. Some kind of algorithm, whatever they mapped it out, whatever it should be, and it's going to follow that, and there we go. So here's another picture of how it works. So we have a camshaft. Camshaft is pushing on a plunger. So the plunger went up. When it went up, fuel fills the space that's underneath it. Plunger is going to come down. So the plunger is coming down, seals off. No more fuel is filling it up. We're going to start building pressure in here. This is my solenoid, and this is the little valve that's controlling it. So it's either going to block it off. If it blocks it off, pressure is going to build, and it's going to inject. Or it's going to open it up and let the fuel dump out again. So this plunger goes up and down the same amount every single time. And it's going to push the same volume of fuel every single time. Whether it's at full RPM, no RPM, full fuel, no fuel, it goes up the same amount. It will go up, fills the space, it comes down, and we're either going to seal it, push it out the injector, or we're going to open it and dump it back into the tank. That's all it does. So it looks complicated when you actually look at the injector, because this is that same injector, same as that picture we just looked at. So you're like, wow, but I mean, it's just the solenoid, and this is where it's controlling, where it dumps back into the tank or doesn't. And then we just have springs that are balancing and opening up the injector down here at the tip. So it's pretty simple. It's just really, really, really precise. And any kind of little problem in there, yeah, it's expensive. So this is a little clearer picture of that same thing. Got my solenoid. We have our control over here. It's dumping the fuel back. This is my high pressure chamber here. There's my plunger that's coming down. That's actually pushing it down and building it. My fuel supply is coming in, and we have a return line that dumps back into the tank. These kinds of systems tend to have a lot of circulation back to the tank. When it circulates back to the tank, what is it doing? It's cooling the injectors, and that heat is going to the tank. The heat in the tank is heating up the fuel in the tank. So if it's cold weather, that gelling problem that we have kind of starts to go away because I'm putting heated fuel back in the tank, drawing it back up, and my fuel is less likely to gel. So there's a lot of benefits to it. Most big trucks that have this system, you know, the tank is warm. So in the winter, they plug it in. One of those things they plug in is a fuel heater that circulates the fuel and keeps it warm. And then once they start it, the injector pulling heat out of the engine does the same job. Electronically, we just have an electronic signal that goes into my solenoid. It's gonna have a strong magnetic field or a weak magnetic field. Stronger it is, the more it's going to open up, more it's going to dump. The weaker it is, the less is going to go by, more is going to go out the injector tip. So it's just a varying electrical signal that's varying a magnet. We learned about that in the electrical class. So normal orifice should be nice and crisp and square. If you use a wire steel brush, steel wire brush, and clean the tip of an injector, you're going to cause problems. So we have a guy running our camera, and he's going to show you that we have wire brushes. So I have a little yellow box here that says diesel fuel only on it. And in this box are brass brushes. And then we have a steel brush, which you should never be using. Actually, I try not to ever even have a steel brush in there because people will use it. And then we have some bristle brushes. So if I want to clean an injector tip, I pull it out. Sometimes, most of the time, there'll be some carbon buildup. You won't use a steel one, you use a brass one, and we'll clean it with a brass brush. The brass is softer than the carbon. It'll take off the carbon, but it won't actually damage the metal in any way. The second thing that I want to do is when I'm cleaning this, even if I'm trying to play with the tip itself, I want to have some kind of dish that's kind of open. I would want to have some kind of gloves to protect myself. I don't want to be putting my hands in diesel fuel. Then I would actually take diesel fuel, clean diesel fuel, I would pour it into the container, and I would actually take this apart and clean it under the fuel. So while it's in the fuel, I don't use brake clean, I don't use carb clean, I don't use an ultrasonic cleaner, I don't use anything except for diesel fuel. So I take them apart, I take my brass brush, I'm going to clean it in the fuel and rinse it. The dirt will settle out of the fuel. I'll clean it, I'll assemble it, put it back in the machine. So I assemble it. Everything I do is with diesel fuel. So when I take it apart, because I'm wearing gloves, it kind of protects some of that heat movement between the two pieces. I can take the needle apart, I can clean it a little bit. I'll be real careful about that. But want to make sure everything, just kind of wiggle it. It should fit right back in, put it back in the fuel. You're using the lubricating and the cleaning function of the fuel to clean that carbon. So I'm going to loosen it and let it float away. So don't try to clean it in any other way. And really, you want to be wearing gloves. It's not healthy to be soaking your hands in that fuel. So don't use steel brushes, only use a brass brush. Dampening pistons. So in our hydraulics class, we talk about dampening pistons. We have hydraulic cylinders. That on the end of the hydraulic cylinder, that will be a neck down. And here is an example of a hydraulic cylinder with a dampening piston. So as this piston travels up, when this piece reaches this smaller neck down area, it's going to seal it off. When it seals it off, that piston slows down because it can't move fluid as easy, and it's a dampening mechanism. So I'm hydraulically cushioning this so it doesn't come up and slam. So I can vary the flow rate by adding in a hydraulic cushion. And so again, stuff that you learned in other classes, here it is again. So the concept of a hydraulic dampening hydraulic cylinder is used in a fuel injector. So just something neat that's out there. You don't have any way of changing any of this stuff. All you can do is those four checks. What is opening pressure? I can add a shim or subtract a shim. And also laying on the table here is a shim. So let me see if I can get it to fall out. So here is a shim that would go inside of this nozzle. So if I were to take this apart, there's a spring in there. Oops, that one's already missing. Yep. So I'll slide that over here so we can see it. So So this is my pencil injector. We took the tip off. Inside of it is the spring, and on the end of the spring is the shim. And so you can buy a package that has various size shims. You put it in, you measure the pressure, you go to your technical manual. The technical manual says every 25, every 10,000 increase in shim raises the pressure 500 pounds. So it'll tell you how much each shim will raise the pressure. So you go through with your caliper and you find the shim, you put it in, you retest it, and it should follow through. So we can do that. We can clean. We can change the tip. We can polish that surface if it's a little bit wore, if you have the right lapping compound and the right table to do it on. Outside of that, you would send it to a repair shop. If you weren't comfortable with it, there are diesel repair shops like Wentland Diesel here in our town, and that's what they do. They rebuild injectors and they rebuild pumps. When you pull that pump to send it in, it's going to be somewhere between $900 and $5,000. Virtually most pumps that you take on are somewhere between $900 and $1,800 for them to rebuild a pump. Injectors, I think they charge about $25, $30 an injector just to test it. And then when they rebuild them, it's the cost of the tip. These tips here, this little tip, I want to think that this little tip was about $35. So it's really not extremely expensive. If it is worn and you have a bad pattern, it's worth just replacing it. If this is shooting streams out to the side, that's not burning very well, you're going to have excess fuel buildup in that engine cylinder, and that's going to cause varnish buildup, coking, carbon buildup, and it's going to damage your piston. So we do not want to have a bad injector tip for $35 a piece. This one has three. These little engines have three. So you're looking for $100. I can replace all three tips. It would be something that you would want to do. That's a maintenance item that the technician should be following through with. So that covers all that. Another thing I want to show while we're here is this is the pipe that carries the fuel to each injector, and if I stop moving, you'll see that the hole that's in the pipe is very, very small. So you can pass that one around so you can keep hanging on to it. I'll hold on to this one. So this one is very small. The pipe itself is super thick. You don't just take some copper pipe or something that's laying around and build one of these. The second thing is, let's say it's a three-cylinder engine. Three-cylinder engine, the length of the pipe is exactly identical on every single cylinder. So when you look at them, they kind of zigzag around and they kind of come together. You're like, I don't know why they bent these all around like that. They bend them around so that they're all the same length. So they start out with the same length and then they bend them to kind of fit. And so it's a lot of extra length. And the reason why is because fuel, even though it's pretty solid, fuel has a little bit of cushion. To get the same amount of fuel to each injector, I have to push the same column of fuel. So you don't just find another pipe laying around and stick it on there. It has to be a pipe for that engine so that it's the right length. So be careful about that.
I just learned that about electricity too.
When you take wire and you bend it real sharp, it's going to affect how things flow. So that curvature helps with the curving of the wire. So these are precise. They're specifically made for your engine. They're the same length, and they're not just simple material. And you think that thick of metal, it doesn't move, but it does. And so we're going to show you, probably in a different film, the piezometer that I talked about and a little handheld device that we can clamp on. We take the paint off because paint's affecting it. So we'll take and we sand the paint off, and then this little tool just clamps on here. And I can tell you what RPM your engine's running at simply by clamping that on. And that piezometer is actually measuring the flexing of this metal pipe. at the low pressures, like this system is only going to be 1800 psi. So 1800 psi, it flexes that pipe enough that we can actually detect it. So imagine if you're at 220,000 psi, or you're at 40,000 with some of these crazy ones that are out there. They have a lot of pressure on there. When I was at the Kohler class, one of the things that they told us was if you crack any fitting on their system, any fitting, you have to replace the whole thing. So you can't buy just the pipe, you have to buy the common rail tube and all the fittings that attach to it, because they're such high pressure. When you crack that fitting, we can't guarantee you that you didn't actually distort the metal. And so they don't just sell one piece, they sell it as a unit, it's all together. And you bolt it on, so you don't crack fittings to kind of bleed it, you don't crack fittings to see if I got fuel there, you don't touch the system unless you plan on buying the piece. It's like buying a whole wire harness. So you buy the whole fuel line system from the common rail parts, everything from the high pressure pump to the injector port, all that comes as one. And imagine, I mean, you look at this at a low pressure system, how crazy it is. Now go to this 30,000 psi, it's a lot of flexing, a lot of pressure in there. So be very careful with fuel systems. And that is chapter 9.